2007 would be a very special election for me, as it represented the first election I actually remember experiencing. Arriving back in Australia the previous year, after years of living overseas, I vividly remember as a 12-year-old going to the polling booth with my parents and waiting outside while they cast their votes. Meanwhile, a pilot in a Skyrider wrote out KR07 in the sky to show his support for then opposition leader Kevin Rudd. So let me take a nostalgic look back on this historic election as we dive into the election of 2007. Following the election of 2004, Prime Minister John Howard had emerged stronger than ever, with a giant 27-seat majority in the lower house, and, for the first time since the 70s, complete control of the Senate. Using this power, Howard and his Treasurer Peter Costello would finally implement their economic reforms without any need to win over minor parties. These reforms would include the total privatisation of Telstra, Australia's main telecommunications company, and the controversial Workplace Relations Agreement. This amendment, more commonly referred to as work choices, planned to massively deregulate Australia's employment market. This included exemptions for certain companies to not be subjected to unfair dismissal laws, restrictions on when a union could undertake industrial action, and streamline the bodies which oversaw the employment market. Work choices would receive a massive backlash not only from the Labor Party, but Australians as a whole, who feared worsening work conditions and pay if the amendment was passed. As a result, a huge campaign emerged to block the passage of the amendment, and attention soon turned to National Senator Barnaby Joyce to break party ranks and block the bill after he expressed certain doubts on work choices. However, Joyce would end up passing the bill, which came into law in 2006. With the amendment passed, Howard had hoped opposition for the policy would die down. However, the opposite happened, and the public became more opposed to the policy, as it saw a massive decline in the coalition's popularity. While Howard attempted to push through his economic agenda, disaster would strike the wider global region when on the 26th of December 2004, a magnitude 9.3 earthquake off the coast of Sumatra would create a giant tsunami which would race across the Indian Ocean, devastating the impoverished communities which relied along the coastline and killing almost 250,000 people. Howard would immediately rush to pledge Australia's support for its local neighbours and would push forward $1 billion aid package to help the disaster-stricken areas. While Howard was quick to respond to the disaster, Labour opposition leader Mark Latham, who was on holiday at the time, would not issue any statements, instead leaving it to acting opposition leader Chris Evans. No, not that one. Thank you. Latham's inactions would be heavily criticised by the media, and his approval polls would take a sharp decline. As a result, Latham would resign the leadership and leave Parliament, becoming the shortest-serving leader of the party since Billy Hughes, and the first to have never held a ministerial office since Matthew Charlton. With Latham gone and nobody willing to take up the leadership, the role would again fall to good old Kim Beazley, becoming the first man to lead the Labour Party twice. Upon taking over the leadership, Beazley would attempt to recover the Labour Party's image following the 2004 election. He would do this by going on the offensive and attacking the Coalition for Work Choices and the Australian Wheat Board scandal, in which Australia's public wheat exporter was found to have been giving huge kickbacks to the Saddam regime in Iraq. However, these attacks soon began to get out of hand when Beazley broke parliamentary convention during the 2006 budget and questioned the government over the AWB scandal instead of the budget itself. To some, Beazley was acting out of desperation as he continued to poll behind Howard as preferred Prime Minister. Beazley was no longer seen as the young fresh face who almost led the Labour Party to victory in 1998 and 2001. Instead, he was seen as yet another tired old politician who was past his time. With the public clamouring for new leadership in the Labour Party, a certain Kevin Rudd would make his move. Born in Nambour, Queensland, Rudd would have a brutal upbringing from a heart disease to the early death of his father. Despite these trials, Rudd would go on to have a solid education at Nambour State High School, along with a certain Wayne Swan, and he would get a degree in Asian Studies at the Australian National University, becoming proficient in Mandarin.
Australia跟中国是一样的。
Rudd was a strong admirer of former Prime Minister Gough Whitlam, who he praised for allowing an impoverished person like him the chance to go to university. Rudd's first major foray into politics would be for his own state Queensland Labor Party, where he became the chief of staff for party leader Wayne Goss. As chief of staff, Rudd would lead the 1989 election campaign, which ended the three decades of National Party rule and made Goss premier. Following the election, Rudd would remain in his role where he helped develop a lot of the government's policies before it was eventually defeated in the 1996 Mundingburra by-election. Following the state government's downfall, Rudd would move into federal politics, winning the seat of Griffith in the 1998 election, after originally failing to win it in 1996. Rudd would soon move into the shadow cabinet following the 2001 election, and would toy with running for the leadership following Crean and later Latham's resignations. However, it took until 2006 for him to finally make the move. In an attempt at pushing a unified challenge, Rudd would team up with his political rival, Julia Gillard, to challenge Beazley for the leadership. The vote would occur on the 4th of December 2006, and Rudd would emerge victorious with 49 votes to Beazley's 39. And with that, Rudd would become the 18th leader of the Labor Party, along with Julia Gillard, as the first ever female deputy leader in the party's history. As the man who took down one long-standing right-wing government, Rudd would immediately attack the coalition where it hurt. He would attack their record on industrial relations, lack of Indigenous reconciliation, and the failure to tackle climate change, which was increasingly becoming a bigger issue following several studies showing how carbon dioxide emissions were causing global temperatures to rise across the planet. With these attacks, Labor would again begin polling above the coalition and by much larger margins than before. Howard would attempt to repeat his 2004 strategy and would attempt to portray Rudd as yet another young and competent leader like Latham, explaining that
"This country does not need new leadership. It does not need old leadership. It needs the right leadership. Love me or loathe me, the Australian people know where I stand on all the major issues of importance to their future."
However, Rudd was a much better debater and was able to avoid the pitfalls which Latham had succumbed to, and with that, Labor continued to pull further and further ahead. With Election Day approaching, it was looking increasingly likely that Labor would win, even with their 27-seat deficit. As a result, Howard considered the possibility of stepping down as Prime Minister and giving it over to a younger face. Howard's deputy, John Anderson, had already passed on the role of National Party leader onto Mark Vaile back in 2005, and pressure was mounting in the Liberal Party for Howard to do the same. This movement would be led by Costello, who argued that he was entitled to the top job based on former agreements made. Despite the sizeable support for new leadership, Howard refused to step down unless the party publicly admitted they wanted him to go. With the leadership change right before an election being political suicide, the party would fall in line behind Howard, much to the frustration of Costello, who had yet again been deprived the top job. Despite remaining as leader, Howard made it clear that this would be his last election, and he would step aside next year. With Election Day set for the 24th of November 2007, the campaign was on as Howard desperately tried to regain the public's support. He would attempt to run on the economy, which had prospered under the coalition's fourth term. This initially would see some success in reducing Labor's polling advantage by roughly 2%. However, Labor continued to remain solidly in the lead. Rudd's campaign would adopt the slogan, Kevin 07, which soon became a popular catchphrase going into the election. Rudd himself would attack the coalition's anti-worker policy and would have even more policies like work choices in a re-elected coalition government. He also promised a national apology to all Indigenous Australians for the brutal treatment they received under Australia and its previous colonies. Meanwhile, the Democrats' leader, Lynn Allison, would team up with Bob Brown's Greens and several other third parties to launch the Bring Back the Balance campaign, which sought to bring back a divided Senate and prevent one party controlling both houses of Parliament and passing whatever legislation they felt like. The campaign would soon be joined by Get Up, an activist group spawned to oppose Howard's Senate majority, and they would run a major campaign on the internet which had become widely used by Australians across the nation. As Election Day approached, the campaign turned messy when Health Minister Tony Abbott turned up late to a debate with his shadow counterpart Nicola Roxon, and during the debate on asbestos, seemingly showed little empathy for a terminally ill asbestos victim. Roxon would press Abbott more after the debate on his punctuality and behaviour, to which Abbott was caught on the microphone saying,
It certainly wasn't intentional.
Rudd was also having to battle some challenges to his character after it was revealed he went into a strip club during a recent visit in New York. However, Rudd was able to brush these accusations off, and the incident would end up humanising him more. And with that, Australia would head to the polls for what was going to be the election of the decade. And the winner was? While some Liberal commentators had hoped their giant House majority would protect them, it became very clear that Rudd had won, picking up 23 seats to hold 83. This came with a giant 5.44% swing in the two-party preferred towards Labour, the largest swing since 1975. The largest of these swings came from Rudd's own state of Queensland, where the party had picked up 9 seats, the most of any state, along with a 7.53% swing in the two-party preferred. Born in 1957, Rudd would be the first baby boomer Prime Minister, and the first to not represent a Victorian or New South Wales seat since fellow Queenslander Frank Ford in 1945. Howard's reign as Australia's second longest serving Prime Minister had come to an end, not only with a brutal loss of 22 seats to hold 65, but also the loss of Howard's own seat of Benelong to journalist Maxine McHugh, making Howard only the second Prime Minister to lose his own seat since Stanley Bruce in 1931. With the loss of their leader, the Liberal Party had to immediately elect a new leader. Despite coveting the position for years and receiving Howard's endorsement, Treasurer Peter Costello shocked the nation when he said he would not seek the leadership, saying that he was too closely associated with the Howard government that the public had so thoroughly rejected. Costello would leave politics for good 2 years later, ending his time as Australia's longest-serving Treasurer. Howard and Costello weren't the only ones to be leaving Canberra. Despite their support behind the Bring Back the Balance campaign, the Democrats had failed to regain their support, and with a pathetic 1.29% of the vote, they had been wiped out for good, and in the party's reign as Australia's longest-serving third party. While the Bring Back the Balance campaign had failed to save the Democrats, it was successful in ending the coalition's Senate majority, with the coalition losing 2 seats to hold 37. The Greens had gained 1 seat to now hold 5, ensuring they were now the new main third party in the Senate. Meanwhile, popular South Australian independent Nick Xenophon would also make his move into federal government after decades of serving in state politics, bringing more third party voices into the upper house. In a similar manner to his idol, Gough Whitlam, Rudd would shake up Labour Party norms when he announced his ministry without consulting his caucus. This ministry included fellow Nambour State High School graduate Wayne Swan, who would take over treasurer for Costello. Meanwhile, the coalition had to elect new leaders, with Nationals leader Mark Vaile also resigning. The Nationals would go with former Minister for Trade Warren Truss, while the Liberals would see a three-way race. Former Defence Minister Brendan Nelson would emerge victorious and would immediately attempt to reform the party away from its unpopular positions, declaring work choices dead and promising never to propose such a policy again. With the federal coalition's government's defeat, Labour now found itself in charge of every single federal, state and territory government, with Brisbane Lord Mayor Campbell Newman representing the highest office in Australia controlled by a Liberal member. Rudd had done what three previous Labour leaders could not and had finally defeated the Howard government. However, soon after taking over as Prime Minister, Rudd would soon be faced with one of the worst economic crises that would forever define his career as Australia's 26th Prime Minister. Come back next time for the election of 2010.